We've already looked at the Leopard 1 tank in an earlier tank chat, and we're now going to follow that up with Leopard 2, the vehicle behind me here. The Leopard 2, it's one of those tanks that again has gone all around the world, a very classic, very famous tank, and in service nowadays, we're talking early 2019, with about 18 countries. So it's a very successful vehicle. The Leopard 1 story we talked about earlier, when a tank in the post-war era, certainly at the time of the Cold War, when a tank went into service, most of the Western governments that were making tanks started the program almost immediately the tank went into service to start the replacement. And that tended to be about a 10-year project if you were lucky, if everything went well for you. Now the Germans, the Leopard 1 started going into service in 1965. The Germans realized they're going to have to do a replacement tank, and they tie up with the Americans, and the Americans are going to be looking at replacing their M60 tanks. And they start a program called MBT-70. Now, the issue about MBT-70 is we often see these projects that don't seem to come to fruition. Here at the Tank Museum, we've got a number of prototypes or testbed vehicles, and often people think they're a failure because they don't actually go into service. But actually, they can be a success in another way, because some of the technologies and the things that are learnt from those programs end up going into the building of another tank that does go into production. And MBT-70 is a classic example of that. What happens is the Americans and the Germans, they tie up, they aim to build the tank together. But immediately these problems arise. Straight away, pretty much every single topic, whether it's the armament, the power pack, the level of protection, all of them, there's huge arguments about. Even to the point of, should they do it in metric or in imperial measurements? That caused a huge amount of debate before that was agreed on. And even there, it was a bit of a fudge compromise. So this project goes ahead, and some of the technologies, after all these arguments, become actually quite forward-looking and very influential. Other bits to us now seemed a bit daft. For example, at the time, MBT-70, they were looking at keeping the profile of the tank very low, so it's less of a target. And that meant that they only wanted it to be just over about 6 foot high. Now that's really low for a main battle tank. If they were going to do that, they then put hydro pneumatic suspension on it, which could raise the tank body up so that the hull was higher off the ground if it was going cross country. So a great deal of complexity there just in the suspension. Another thing they realized, if it's a very low vehicle, where do you put the driver? So they ended up putting the driver in the turret. They gave him his own sort of driving cupola, and it didn't matter where the turret angled, the driver would still be looking forward at where the main body of the tank was going. Or they could swivel his position round and he could drive the vehicle backwards by looking backwards as well. Again, another layer of complexity. They were going to put a 152mm gun on, the same as on the Sheridan. They were looking at spaced armour. They were looking at all sorts of newer concepts on this vehicle. But the costs rose, delays in some of the technologies not being mature enough to be able to be used. And in the end, by 1970, that MBT-70 project was abandoned. US Congress, there was too much money being spent on it. They stopped that. Now, the Germans are still in need of this replacement for their Leopard 1 tank. So they take some of the technologies, for example, the idea of this MTU diesel, the Renks transmission system again, and they start building their own version of what they hope is going to be their future main battle tank. And fairly quickly, this becomes the Leopard program. They look at various other bits of technology. They're influenced, for example, in 1973 by the wars in the Middle East. They realise that levels of protection on vehicles are going to have to go up, experiences from those wars. They then sign yet another memorandum of understanding with the Americans. And again, what they're trying to do again, even though they're going their own way, what can we do as commonality of parts, of systems, to lessen the cost? And in doing so, the Germans put together what they call Leopard 2 AV, or austere version. And that becomes a project that they can present to the Americans. And in 1976, a Leopard 2 AV is actually sent to America for trials against what is going to become in the future the first model of Abrams tank. At the time Chrysler were building, it's called the XM1. Those vehicles are put next to each other. As always, almost predicted, it's the Chrysler model that wins for the American in the idea of the evaluation. But what the Americans do, they do pick up the Rheinmetall 120 millimeter gun that was being used on this austere version Leopard 2. The Germans go away, they work on that project. And that ultimately, by the end of the 1970s, has become Leopard 2. The chief contractor that it's given to is Krauf Maffei back in 1978. The first production Leopard 2s, the very first ones, roll off the production line right at the end of 79. They start getting issued to the German troops. And again, as with the Leopard 1 tanks, another series of vehicles are built on the Leopard 2 chassis as well. Now, very early on in this process, the Dutch put an order in 79 saying we're going to have to replace our Centurion tanks. And as part of that process, the Dutch order 445 of these new Leopard 2s. And they order as well about 20 of the training tank versions of Leopard 2s. And this particular Leopard 2 A4 behind me is one of the Dutch vehicles, early days. It's one of the first ones. It goes out, serves out in Germany with Royal Netherlands Army. And this particular vehicle we've got here is actually on loan to us from the Royal Dutch Armies. It's their call of a historic fleet. They call it their props committee, and they turn up at events sometimes with very historic vehicles and leading through to some of the vehicles from much more recent times of the Dutch military. So we're very grateful of having this vehicle here. Good example as well about the whole Leopard 2 story is really what happens is each batch of the Leopard production that comes out has, like Leopard 1, improvements on it. And when foreign countries are ordering the Leopard as well, not that many initially, because Leopard is complex, very expensive, but if you're ordering that vehicle, quite often you specify certain changes. Or, as the Dutch did, 60% of the value of the Leopard order was actually built in Holland. So there's this idea it's either built under license, site changes, or ordered off the Germans, but to meet your national requirements. So, for example, the Leopard 2 A4s ended up, initially they ended up with having a different sighting system, different internal communications, different smoke discharges for the Dutch, and the Dutch use an FN machine gun rather than the MG3 that the Germans were using. So that's why when we're talking about the Leopard program, it can get quite confusing quite quickly because of the range of different models, the upgrades, and the number of times tanks went back to the factories that might have been from an earlier batch, and they got then improved on or rebuilt to a much greater, more modern, more sophisticated standard. So for example, for the German Leopards, really the batch 1 to 4, they all had a small ammunition hatch on the side of the turrets. From batch 4 onwards, that was done away with. The earlier ones were welded up. So again, there's a great long pedigree of changes within the Leopard program. Leopard 2 up to Leopard 2 A4 are the ones with this very distinctive boxy front turret. From Leopard 2 A5, 6 and 7, that's where they've then improved the level of armour to this arrowhead formation. And again, in terms of looking at the vehicles, you'll also notice the L44 calibre gun. We've now gone on to the L55 calibre gun. So that 120mm Rheinmetall gun, if you look on the later models, if you're thinking what's the difference, not only that arrowhead front on the armour, but also the much longer length gun of the L55 is on some of these later ones. So let's look at this as an example of a typical, if we might call it, Leopard 2 A4. What we're looking at here is a vehicle with spaced armour. When the new type of armour came in after Leopard 1, when they're adding this new laminate armour, Britain, by the way, we gave Burlington or Chobham armour to the Germans in 1970. Whether the Germans actually use that, much debate about what type of laminate armour is actually used on Leopard tanks. But on here, the idea being that type of laminate armour, it didn't have an advantage by angling it, hence these front flat compartments, as it looks like as you're looking at the turret. Later, as I said, A6, A7, A5s, they've got the arrowhead, which actually extends the armour much further forward. And again, there's space gaps as well as different materials in that level of frontal protection there. It's got the Renk transmission in it. It's got the MTU diesel engine. You end up at about 25 horsepower a ton. You're looking there, in other words, a very, very powerful power pack. And again, as with earlier Leopard 1, quick release couplings. You can change that engine if you're good at your job, 15, 20 minutes. That's the idea, so that again in the field, an engine change can happen relatively speedily. Lots of power in that MTU 12-cylinder diesel. So again, speed is pretty good on this vehicle. You're looking at about 72 km/h on the roads. Half that speed in reverse, and that's another important feature this vehicle's got. You know, it's quite amazing seeing how quickly it can go backwards. On this vehicle, you've got a crew of four, three traditional crew member placements in the turret. You've still got a loader here. You've got a gunner who sits in front of the commander. The gunner's system on for this vehicle, they put a new laser rangefinder in the Leopard 2. They put a new computing system, and basically the laser rangefinder can judge a distance out to about 9,900 meters. A computer takes that distance and adds in factors such as the tilt of the vehicle, the motion of the vehicle, the type of ammunition that is going to be fired, wind direction, and that again is part of the advantages of these very modern, much more sophisticated tanks. The chances of a first round hit and being able to fire on the move go up. So this idea again that in tank-on-tank engagements, one of the big issues that came out through Korea and World War II was it tended to be the first accurate round on target, is a tremendous advantage in a tank-on-tank fight. And this is still a generation of tank that is being built in the environment of the Cold War. They really think this is a vehicle that's going to be there to take on T-72s, later T-80 tanks, or T-64s in large numbers. So that was its primary function at the time. It would carry about 42 rounds of ammunition, some stowed down in a compartment by the driver, the rest in the turret compartment, and that turret compartment has this system that you see on vehicles like the Abrams, where the ammunition is stowed separate to the crew, a door open, ammunition taken out. Big ammunition, we're just under about a metre now for semi-combustible cartridge, but that stowage, why it's so important is again, if there is a secondary fire in the vehicle, the panels above that stowage compartment should blow out if there is an explosion of that ammunition, rather than the crew be affected and they're protected by this the door that separates them. I mentioned the ammunition, two main types they were carrying, an armour piercing, fin stabilised, discarding sabot with a bit of tracer on the end, and they do a heat round as well. And that over time changed with the 120mm Rheinmetall gun. The great advantage was the Americans, after that trial in 1976, they took on that Rheinmetall 120mm gun and built it in America, and that means there was a compatibility of ammunition between the 120 gun on the Leopard tanks and the American M1A1 tanks in America. So again, there's cost savings and supply issues there, which means that you can use each other's ammunition. Semi-combustible, it basically means that the cartridge burns up the propellant and it leaves a little stub, a brass stub, that falls in a bag underneath once it's fired out of here. But you've still got that loader. Again, he's still got to be a fairly beefy guy with the rounds. And again, the whole point about coming back to this generation, when they're firing that armor piercing, fin stabilized, discarding sabot round, we're talking about metal darts. The longer the metal dart, made normally tungsten, sometimes depleted uranium, that length tends to equate to how much armor it can go through. So the longer the dart, the more penetration, and that's why the Rheinmetall 120 gun is such an effective tank killing weapon. Drivers down the front, Three periscopes he's got. He actually drives the vehicle using a little steering yoke that's in front of him. Again, a lot of people will talk about driving a Leopard 2. It's a very relaxing vehicle. I say that in a euphemistic terms, but in the sense it's not that stressful to drive. You don't physically, as some tanks, again with steering levers and gear changes, this is a very sophisticated tank to be able to drive. And also with that power behind you, again, that idea that you can actually motor at speed cross country and also reverse at considerable speed to get out of trouble. So again, driving one of these things, you really got to know your stuff to get the best from it. When we're looking at the later models, the A6 and now the A7, with so many of these vehicles now, what tends to happen is specific packages are put together for certain types of environment. And that kind of takes us on to where the Leopard's been used. The German military took some to Kosovo. They didn't really see any action as such there. They were there really as a peace enforcement. But 2007, the British were looking at taking tanks. Canadians actually took their Leopards and the Danes to Afghanistan. And that was really interesting because actually everyone wondered about using something like a big heavy tank in counterinsurgency role. Actually, the Western Allies, NATO forces that were in Afghanistan found the tanks being there was a tremendous advantage. And it also led to some of these up-armouring packages being delivered. So, for example, they bought the Barracuda system off of Sweden, which you can see goes over some of the Danish Leopards and Canadian Leopards. And again, that reduces the heat signature of the vehicle, acts as a bit of camouflage. But the other thing it also does is it suppresses the heat levels inside the vehicle for the crews. Because of IEDs, they up the armor, sometimes on the belly. They add bar armor around the rear, sometimes reactive armor packages. So lots of other bits and pieces there added onto vehicles, depending on the nature of the threat. And the key issues, what came out from Afghanistan, we actually spoke to the commander of the Danish Leopards. He gave a wonderful talk afterwards. A number of issues. The fact that the gun was so accurate, it meant you lessened the idea of collateral damage. The fact that infantry felt so much better with armoured support in an overwatch position. The levels of protection on something like a main battle tank meant they could go to places and take risks that other lighter vehicles just simply couldn't do. And one of the key elements, he said as well, is there was days, he said, we turned up with our tanks, we didn't have to fight. We were the biggest stick in the valley. And that, it's just sheer physical presence, meant no one took them on. And again, so actually, yet again, that adaptability of the tank was seen there in that role in counterinsurgency in Afghanistan. Interestingly, of course, the Canadians had got to the point before going to Afghanistan where they were taking on a lighter armoured vehicle, Stryker. They didn't think there was going to be the need for heavy armour anymore, and they were getting rid of their Leopard 1 tanks. The experience in Afghanistan led them to actually order more Leopard 2s from the Germans, and they're back in service. And again, that same story with the Royal Netherlands Army. They ended off selling on, as so many, Germany as well, selling on their Leopard 2 tanks to other countries. There's now 18 countries using Leopard 2 around the world. But the Royal Netherlands Army, then again, just like the Canadians, realised, hang on a second, we're going to still need tanks. So they actually hire, in essence, a battalion of Leopard 2 A7s from the German Army, and they actually train with one of the German Panzer units. So again, that idea about we say goodbye to the tank, and for some peculiar reason, they come back again. Those Leopards sold all around the world, many countries now using Leopards, again in slightly different configurations, as we mentioned earlier. Turkey, 300 Leopards sold by Germany. And really, that's the first time we've been seeing Leopards destroyed in combat when Turkey's incurred into Syria. There's been a number of losses there. Mainly, if I was honest, when you analyse it, probably not great tactical use of the items, not because, as the press, every time a major tank gets knocked out, the press tends to start, oh, the death of the tank, here we go again, stories of we'll never be able to see tanks around. So that Leopard story continues. They're up to about Leopard 2 A7 at the moment. Lots of different packages coming together as well. And a continuation, not just of the Leopard program, But again, the designers of Leopard 2 or the companies involved now looking with France to build another generation main battle tank, other countries showing some interest. So whether we call it Leopard, Eurotank, something else in the future, who knows? But certainly these vehicles, their story is not over. We're based here at the Tank Museum at Bovington, and we're actually an independent charity. And we do these tank chats to share the knowledge, share the collection with people. But the truth is, we need your support if we're going to be able to continue doing this. And that's why we've set up various schemes of ways you can support us. One of the obvious ones is Patreon. If you're prepared to pay us online a few dollars, then that means it helps sustain the program of us being able to make these films and hopefully make them better, increase the range of what we're doing here. So if you are already supporting us, thank you as ever. Do press those like buttons, do subscribe to our series, and please, if there is an opportunity, please do try and support us financially as well. Thank you.